Stimson, this will be no ordinary day.
This is the train for Norwich.
Plymouth.
Plymouth?
Put your money in the box, caller.
I put my money in the box. It's eaten the money. I haven't got any more money.
This is how mankind has evolved from the primeval slime, by adapting to circumstance.
John Cleese stars in Clockwise, 10:20 on Christmas Day on BBC One.
And this evening's late film on BBC One is the smash hit Love Story, a boy meets girl romantic encounter tinged with tragedy between Ally McGraw and Ryan O'Neill. That's in an hour. This is BBC One, and now, this Christmas Eve, we go to Belfast, where Father Jim Skerry introduces Midnight Mass of the Nativity from the Redemptorist Church at Clonard. Christmas night, we welcome you to West Belfast.
Is Dhaka throwing Martin Warren to his horrible pet alligators? And will the Jap spies force Linda to give them the receipt for the vital radium shipment they plan to steal? Don't fail to see Slaves of the Rising Sun, Chapter 4 of Batman, at this theater next week.
Well, you don't have to wait that long, because the Batman will be back tomorrow at 10:35, as will Tintin just before him. A double helping of adventure, all week long.
This Christmas on 4, take a journey into your dreams with Rog. Wake up now. There's work to be done on Animal Farm. Animation meets live action in Alice. And there are two films from Jim Henson. Harry Dean Stanton stars in Monster Maker and in Living with Dinosaurs.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog.
The star of the show is obvious. Here's another star to brighten your Christmas, Grandpa. An animating Christmas on 4.
Nonny ran as fast as she could, but her muscles ached. She could hardly run. The cat was getting closer, closer. She could barely breathe. Only a miracle could save her now.
The miraculous story of a silent mouse and a Christmas carol, next on 4.
Sinutab clears the congestion here, relieves pain quickly here. Sinutab relieves sinus pain and headache fast.
Alibi.
I don't care what planet she's from, you're 4 seconds late. Nice wheels. Shame to have to lose them.
Lose them?
He's only gone and bought it.
The Renault 19 Chamard, a new saloon from £7,495.
The Payless DIY sale starts tomorrow with prices chopped by up to 50%. And just for Boxing Day, an extra 10% off everything. The Payless DIY sale.
Kenco really know how to make a great cup of coffee.
That's delicious.
coffee drinkers go out of their way for Kenco.
And here comes Hurst. He's got some people are on the pitch. They think it's all over. It is.
Yes. Why, it seems like only yesterday.
And Bobby Moore comes up to receive the Jules Rimet Trophy.
And to think, I was there in the flesh.
The Jules Rimet Trophy. The Jules Rimet Trophy.
Once you've got it on scotch, you've got it for life.
Purcell Green Cap.
Hello, Eddie.
Cap.
Purcell Green Cap.
Purcell Red Cap.
Green Cap.
Purcell Red Cap.
Purcell Red Cap.
You can now buy another Purcell liquid. Original non-biological. With a red cap.
From Walt Disney, this Christmas, Oliver and Company, great family entertainment. And from Kentucky Fried Chicken, something new for the kids. This exciting Oliver and Company flashing headband, $1.59 with any chicken purchase. Another great idea from Kentucky Fried Chicken. The secret's in the taste.
Coffee, mate.
Oh, haven't you got any milk?
Not sure I'm gonna like this.
It's always a first time.
Nice. Very nice.
A veritable masterpiece, known for a true Christmas story, and one of the strangest and the squeakiest you're ever likely to hear.
We'll take account of kindness yet for all.
Well done, Ernest. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Happy New Year, my love.
After the break, success takes its toll on singing star Karen Carpenter in our movie premiere.
While they're pretending not to notice that your nose is feeling beastly, along comes a beastly sore throat. This is when Hall's Mentholyptus can transform you. As Hall's soothing eucalyptus melts away the discomfort from your throat, it releases penetrating menthol vapor action to ease your breathing. Rejoin the human race with your favorite Hall's Mentholyptus.
From Land's End to John O'Groats, smart non-taxpayers are getting even more out of life. They've spotted that National Savings Income Bonds don't take tax off their interest like their local bank or building society has to. And the interest is now 12.5% gross a year, paid as monthly income. So, see what National Savings can do for your savings. We are Britain's biggest savings specialist.
We've got some smart people around here.
Barbara Streisand sings a new collection of greatest hits and more.
And we got nothing to begin to young. Our love will come.
The incomparable voice.
Can we try? Just one time.
With songs of joy and deep emotion. Get this new collection of 12 superb songs. Greatest hits and more from Barbara Streisand.
Thinks you're wonderful.
special.
He thinks you're lovely!
You are lovely, aren't you? Aren't you? Aren't you?
Interflora, guaranteed to get to her.
When it finds you, a cold will make you suffer by day and by night. Day and night bring misery. Now a day and night brings 24-hour relief from cold and flu symptoms. Three tablets for daytime relief, from runny nose, headaches, shivering, and one for easier breathing, helping you to sleep. Five complete 24-hour treatments at your command, day and night, from the makers of Benylin.
The new-look Texas Superstore at Mallings Industrial Estate Lewis is reopened now. Just in time for the Texas winter sale, where we've £500,000 worth of extra savings every day till Tuesday. Well, good news always travels fast.
At Court's sensational winter sale, there are huge savings in all departments. Superb upholstery with three-piece suites from under £300 to nearly £1,000. Big bargains in bedrooms and single divan sets from under £50 and doubles from under £100. A wide selection of all units and dining sets from under £140 to nearly £600. And a dazzling range of carpets. Come and be spoilt for choice at Court's sensational winter sale. On now.
Watch out for a feature-length edition of Taggart. A body recovered from the Clyde and a bizarre double murder raises sinister questions as a community closes ranks.
How long's she been down there?
More than a couple of days.
Are you telling me that some maniac lured her down here?
They soon won't be calling it culture, say. They'll be calling it murder, say.
Don't take us personally, sir.
A special edition of Taggart, 8:30, New Year's Day, on TBS.
Tonight at 9:25, Cilla rings out the decade with the stars at the London Palladium. But now our movie premiere, The Karen Carpenter Story.
Allied sale is now on with hundreds of extra special savings for the first 7 days. Save £5 a square yard on this superb colour roll Axminster carpet. And this top quality Cosset Stainmaster carpet's half price. Save on these beautiful velour ready-made curtains. And this stylish three-piece suite's only £499. Save on famous name beds too. This Dorlux double divan's less than half price. You can't beat the extra special first 7 day savings in the Allied sale on now.
Oh, Jan, it's me.
We're all a bit more health conscious these days, aren't we? I eat these low-fat meals from Birdseye called Healthy Options. Tandoori chicken masala. Marinated pieces of chicken in a spicy curry sauce. And man-sized portions. Hello, Jeffrey. I was just talking about you.
Now you don't have to be health mad to take the healthy option.
Any day, every day, there's one sign that says you're welcome. A visit to McDonald's brings you day.
Quarter pound of paper, mac and french fries, fruit pies, milkshake, coffee on the side. Look, D-O-N-A-L-D-S, nothing but our very best.
Panasonic have come up with a completely different line of thought on programming the video. The barcode scanning system is so simple, you need never miss the arts, the wildlife, or the sport. It's almost impossible to go wrong. So there's never been an easier way to get a beautiful picture. Video recorders with digital programming from Panasonic. The state of the art.
Throat are feeling beastly, take Halls Mentholiptus. Rejoin the human race with your favorite Halls Mentholiptus.
When you tuck your children in at night, are you putting them to bed or laying them to rest? If inhaled, the smoke from a house fire could kill a small child in under a minute. They'll rely on you to wake them up and get them out. What are you relying on? Wake up. Get a smoke alarm.
Next Saturday, a chilling new version of Robert Louis Stevenson's classic horror story, Jekyll and Hyde.
That man died last night. You killed him.
He's coming, Sarah.
Who is Hyde?
The devil.
Help me!
Michael Caine stars in Jekyll and Hyde, next Saturday at 9 on TBS.
Rowan Atkinson. He's reckless on the road. He's myopic in a motor. Watch out for him as Mr. Bean. New Year's Day at 8 on TBS.
The MFI sale, 40, 45, even 50% off Hygiena bedrooms with every unit reduced. Guaranteed unbeatable prices at the MFI sale. Open New Year's Day.
Then you have to buy.
No, Nigel, investments. You want to know about investments.
Well,
turnip.
Pardon?
Invest in the noble turnip. Within 3 years at the current rate of inflation, with increasing demand, I stand to make a pretty tidy sum.
But they'll give you a very reasonable rate at the Alliance and Leicester, just over the road. Your money's safe and it's earning interest all the time.
Never, Nigel, never invest in a company with orange in its logo. Ah, that is excellent news.
You get a smarter investor at the Alliance and Leicester.
This is a pint of ordinary lager. And this is low-alcohol lager. Now, some low-alcohol lagers are around one-third the strength of ordinary lager, so three of these could contain the same amount of alcohol as one of those. Now, this is Caliber from Guinness. And because it's alcohol-free, you can drink as much as you like.
Classic from Castella, for the man who thinks that little bit bigger.
That'll be the phone. Don't move. Hello?
Mom, it's Melvin. I'm wearing it now. It's great.
And what do you think of the turtleneck? I'm making one for your father, but I don't think he's got the neck for it.
The neck's fine.
And the colour?
Camel. I like camel.
It's taupe. They call it taupe.
Okay, so I like taupe.
But you'd have preferred the camel.
Mom, I love it. It's terrific.
Melvin, what about the motif? You've got to have a motif. You ask your Anthony. He's with it.
It's all fine. I love it. I'm ecstatic. I'm over the moon.
So you like it? You're pleased? Oh, good. Bye-bye. He doesn't like it.
Phone to say thank you. It's always appreciated.
He will like it. It'll grow on him. When he gets the matching socks, he'll love it. The whole ensemble.
British Telecom. It's you we answer to.
At Court's sensational winter sale, there are huge savings in all departments. Superb upholstery with three-piece suites from under £300 to nearly £1,000. Big bargains in bedrooms and single divan sets from under £50 and doubles from under £100. A wide selection of all units and dining sets from under £140 to nearly £600. And a dazzling range of carpets. Come and be spoilt for choice at Court's sensational winter sale. On now.
Cilla Black is joined by a host of stars to bid goodbye to the 80s. Watch her tonight at 9:25 on TBS.
Tim Hunkin has written and drawn a special broadsheet with details of the machines covered in this series. For your copy, send a cheque or postal order for £1.50, payable to Channel 4, to Secret Life of Machines 3, P.O. Box 4000, London W36XJ. And if you'd like details of the Channel 4 Science Club or Tim Hunkin's lecture tour based on this series, please send a large, stamped-addressed envelope to Hunkin's Tour at the same address.
We know what the sun... Course we do!
Course we do!
Course we do!
Goes like this, doesn't it?
Wandsworth Prison opens its doors next tonight at a time when management and prison officers are locked in industrial dispute. Turning the Screws follows both sides of the argument against the tense backcloth of everyday prison life.
Urgent facts from head office, Mr. Mellish.
This arrived yesterday.
We're very busy, Mr. Mellish.
Your fax room can sometimes let you down. But the new personal phone with fax is small, fully featured, and costs only £299.99, excluding VAT. So you can receive and send faxes from your desk or coffee table, and even get £25 off your Mercury phone bill if you become a new residential user. The new phone with fax from Amstrad.
Boy who played triangle in the FBL whilst making an LP and CD for RCA was caught eating a cheese sarnie under his DJ with HP. Everything's okay with HP.
You know, can I make photocopies that can work twice as fast as your average copier? This means you can do whatever you want in half the time, leaving you the other half to do whatever you want. Time flies when you're having fun. On paper, if anyone can, Canon can.
Are you insured?
Oh, this is bad news.
In times of disaster, who do you call?
My property's burned downstairs and upstairs. My life is finished.
The assessors?
We try and get you the maximum, obviously under the terms of your policy.
Or the adjusters?
But there are... I want documentation to support
there
you.
There are.
I expect them to send somebody along who knows what they're doing.
Cutting Edge follows the claimsmen, Monday at 9 on 4.
In an hour's time, dead donkeys will be plummeting. This is Channel 4 gaining access to Wandsworth Prison and the key to turning the screws. The programme contains explicit language.
Last November marked the 140th anniversary of the building of this establishment. The Victorians, being very far-sighted, actually had running water and basins and toilets in every cell. That's all been ripped out. When the prison was completed in 1851, there were 760 vacancies. 40 years on, we have doubled that.
There have been people in the past who suggested that the place should be burned to the ground, but an awful lot of change is going on at Wandsworth, and all for the better.
Launches a new range of practical offers, each designed to help you drive your choice of a new Ford now. We send the details of our current offers to your home. You choose the combination that best suits you. Blueprint for a new Ford. Call 0800-111-222 for your free copy.
Danny Glover.
I'm too old for this.
And Mel Gibson.
I'm jumping! Do you really want to jump? Let's do it.
In the action movie, Lethal Weapon, maverick cop Mel Gibson goes all out to fight crime Monday at 9 on Meridian.
You ever met anybody you didn't kill?
Now back to this evening at 10:15, Jim Rosenthal introduces championship boxing, the undefeated Herbie Hyde versus Michael Murray, 10:15. Now, Terence, 10 years on TV, the following programme contains extracts from worldwide television programmes which some viewers may find offensive.
The 80s put an actor in the White House.
There was no man in America to match him. The only man to match him was in Britain, and she was a woman.
Political figures became celebrities, and celebrities became political figures.
Give us the money. There are people dying now, so give me the money.
The force of fame had been tamed, or so it seemed.
For the amateur actors who muffed their lines, the whole show threatened to come apart.
Clive James, Fame in the 20th Century, Wednesday, 9:30 on BBC One.
Among the subjects Jeremy Paxman is discussing in Did You See on BBC Two now, the Public Eye special Cole and the Doll, and Diana, Her True Story. Subjects as diverse as Austro-Hungarian dual monarchy and railway signalling in Britain will be coming up in 20 minutes here on BBC One in Mastermind. Now, the news with Martin Lewis and the time, 9:25.
The Home Secretary plans a change in the law to deal with persistent, nasty juvenile offenders. Mr. Clark wants escape-proof centres where such offenders under the age of 15 can be held and educated. Salman Rushdie asks for a meeting with the Prime Minister to bring pressure on Iran to lift its death threat. And 400 men are lifted off a North Sea accommodation rig that broke loose in storm force winds. Good evening. The Home Secretary, Kenneth Clark, has decided to change the law to crack down on persistent juvenile offenders. He described those youngsters he was targeting as nasty little pieces of work and said he'd be placing proposals before the Commons to establish secure accommodation for offenders under the age of 15. Mr. Clark also plans tougher sentences for people who commit crimes while out on bail. The moves follow the Prime Minister's call for the public to launch a crusade against crime. In an interview in the Mail on Sunday, Mr. Major said, society needs to condemn a little more and understand a little less.
Rising concern over the level of crime, particularly juvenile crime such as joyriding, is prompting the Conservatives to reassert their claim to be the party of law and order. Earlier this month, the Prime Minister stressed the need to maintain concepts of right and wrong. Today he called on the public to condemn rather than understand crime, while pointing to two government initiatives. First, he picked up on promises made before the election for a bill to tackle crimes committed on bail. He said that those who abuse the right to bail can expect to be punished more severely. And he hinted at tougher sentences for juvenile offenders. He said, "We instill in their minds that there is nothing people can do to take action against their bad behaviour." Since Lord Whitelaw announced the short, sharp shock in 1979, the Tories have been struggling with juvenile crime, their failures blamed on society at large.
All of us, of course, have to ask, what is it at the heart of society that leads to a weakening of the values which, in days gone by when the social problems were very much worse, which they certainly were when I was a child, led to less criminality because there was an underlying sense of behaviour that stopped people committing quite so much crime.
Increasingly, Labour is raising its profile on law and order challenging the Tories on their home ground by demanding tougher action.
But we also believe that you've got to try and intervene and target and help divert them from ever becoming persistent young offenders, so that you're both tough on crime and tough on the causes of crime.
Both major parties feel there's a moral and social malaise that has to be addressed, and Labour will be unveiling its proposals for tackling youth crime tomorrow. For Labour, the potential risk is that calling for tougher sentencing may not please all its own supporters. For the Tories, the problem is that no amount of determined talk can alter the fact that public concern is as strong as ever, despite 14 years of Conservative rule.
The parents of the murdered toddler James Bulger have joined police in appealing to the people of Merseyside to stay calm when two 10-year-olds accused of the crime appear in court tomorrow. This morning, prayers were said for James and his family at the Roman Catholic Cathedral in Liverpool. The congregation were asked to pray for all those whose lives have been destroyed by acts of senseless violence. James' body was found near a railway line last Sunday. He had disappeared 2 days earlier while out shopping with his mother. The author Salman Rushdie has asked for an official meeting with the Prime Minister to show Iran that its death threat against him is unacceptable. During a live broadcast on BBC television, Mr. Rushdie, who's been in hiding for the past 4 years, said he hoped for increased international pressure to force Iran to lift the fatwa issued against him.
Salman Rushdie sees himself as the last hostage of the Middle East crisis and refuses to keep quiet about it. His security advisers insist he's in as much danger now as when the threat was first made. He appears confident the government will give his case a higher profile.
Well, I think the thing that I would really love at this moment, it's a symbolic gesture but an important one, is a meeting, on the record meeting with the Prime Minister. I think that's important. I mean, there's a request formally gone in, it's on the table, for two reasons. First of all, I think it's crucial to show Iran that we mean business. And in a way, nothing will do that other than the head of the government standing next to me and saying, we will protect our citizens.
Mr. Rushdie took encouragement from his first visit to the Foreign Office earlier this month and emerged to say he'd been assured of a firm new government policy to highlight his cause. But today, Downing Street said no request for a meeting with the Prime Minister had so far been received, and that no response would be made until it was. Ayatollah Khomeini's death threat was reaffirmed by his successor Ayatollah Khamenei on its fourth anniversary a week ago. Iran's charge d'affaires was called in by the Foreign Office to be told it was a violation of international law. Mr. Rushdie believes there'll be increasing pressure on Iran because of political changes in America.
I mean, the Bush people, frankly, could not have been less helpful. They were not just neutral, they were actually hostile. So for the new administration so rapidly to make a dramatic shift of position and say that this is, in their view, an infringement of international law, and to make such a strong statement of support as the White House did last week, clearly is a very important thing.
Although the original fatwa cannot be reversed, it could be reinterpreted by today's religious leaders. But that won't happen while Iran's fundamentalists remain politically stronger than its reformers.
The new Dutch company making DAF trucks in Europe says it's interested in selling products made by Leyland DAF in Lancashire if a buyer can be found for the British plant. Dutch administrators say they're unable to look at saving British plants because the British government isn't taking part. Leyland DAF is in the hands of receivers.
Workers at Leyland plants in Britain, where over 1,600 jobs have gone, will no doubt be envious that the Dutch and Belgian governments have cut a rescue deal. But there'll be some comfort that the new DAF company in Holland is interested in selling British products from the Leyland truck plant on the continent.
At this stage, we think that the products coming out of this factory are of such a standard and quality that there is a very good potential to sell them into the market. That's the next step.
But the Dutch receivers say they could not include the UK firm in the rescue package because the British government wouldn't intervene. That prompted angry criticism from Labour and the unions.
Today, Dutch workers know their future is secure. British workers don't know what's going to happen to them beyond next week, and that's because the British government has shown no interest in what's going to happen to them.
Mr. Heseltine argued intervention would be the thin end of the wedge.
I don't think it's right for the taxpayer automatically to be expected to pick up the pieces if there were better solutions, alternative solutions. Where would I stop? We are doing what is right, in our view, to get a long-term solution by backing the receiver.
Meanwhile, the UK receivers now say there's agreement with suppliers, allowing production to resume at the Leyland plants tomorrow. And this, in turn, keeps alive attempts to find new owners for the factory.
Three taxi drivers were wounded in a shooting incident in Belfast tonight as they waited for customers near the city centre. The loyalist Ulster Freedom Fighters said they carried out the attack.
Ambulances were on the scene within minutes of the attack. Two of the taxi drivers suffered wounds to their backs, the other was hit in the hand. All three had been in one cab in a taxi rank used by Catholics living in West and North Belfast. It appears that loyalist gunmen drove alongside the rank and at least four shots were fired at the vehicle. The gunman's car was found abandoned a short time later in the Shankill Road. A statement from the paramilitaries tonight described Catholic black taxi drivers as legitimate targets. This is the latest in a growing number of retaliatory attacks carried out by loyalist and Republican gunmen. Less than 24 hours earlier, the IRA shot and critically wounded the doorman of a city centre bar. As his attackers escaped, they shot and wounded two other men who were nearby.
Relays of helicopters have been ferrying nearly 400 oil workers from a floating hostel in the North Sea to Aberdeen. High seas and gales had forced it to break free from the Amoco oil rig, the Lomond. The rescue came after storms lashed the North Sea coast from Scotland to Kent, breaching sea walls and causing floods.
Winds of up to 90 miles an hour delayed the evacuation. The accommodation rig was forced to slip its anchors in the early hours of the morning. The airlift of nearly 400 men, which began this afternoon, lasted up to 7 hours. The oil company, Amoco, says the rig is not drifting, but maintaining its position using its own thrusters. The high winds pushed tide levels up to 3 metres above normal. From Yorkshire to Kent, flood warnings were issued. In East Anglia, the surge damaged coastal defences and there was extensive flooding. More than 600 people were evacuated from homes in Norfolk. There were reports of flooding 20 miles from the coast. In Kent, there was extensive damage. In London, the Thames barrier was closed as the surge combined with river conditions to give a rare double tide. Weathermen at the Met Office headquarters say the high winds caused tides not seen in 10 years, and it could have been far worse.
2 days' time, we actually hit spring tides, which are the highest tides that you can find. And in that case, we'd have had an extra 0.3 of a metre onto the water, which is a massive amount of water to start flooding over.
The evening tide could have caused more damage, and repair crews have been out mending coastal defences. But the danger passed as the wind dropped.
A team of United Nations weapons inspectors is making an unscheduled trip to Iraq tomorrow. UN experts already in Baghdad have told reporters they've gathered fresh evidence on Iraq's ballistic missile programme. The team, led by Nikita Smidovich, is due to fly to Baghdad at dawn. He's refused to say what the team will be doing there or why the operation has apparently been mounted at such short notice. But it is being made clear that the visit is not routine. A UN aid convoy has finally reached the Muslim town of Zepa in eastern Bosnia after local Serb militiamen ended their 2-day roadblock. It's raised hopes that the authorities in Sarajevo will now end their self-imposed boycott and allow the UN to distribute relief supplies in the city.
The Serbs let the UN into Zepa today, keeping their word at last after days of broken promises. The road to Zepa was mined, but the convoy got there.
We have to hope it is the beginning of a trend. We have to hope it is a beginning of the recognition of the right to deliver humanitarian assistance to civilian populations wherever they are, whenever they need it.
But everything is conspiring against ordinary people here, even the weather. This is the worst snow in Sarajevo this winter. The fact it's held off so long has, without doubt, saved thousands of lives. In the Europa Hotel, the only place hundreds of refugees have to call home, they were arguing about the bread ration.
Well,
Why don't you take the lot, one of them said, then the rest of us can starve. There's no food for them tonight, but they have this soup for lunch and a quarter of a loaf of bread. The ration used to be half a loaf. This four-year-old boy is severely anemic. His parents are worried because they want to give him milk and there isn't any. Most of the door and window frames have been taken from the rooms which have been damaged by shells. Now they're sawing up the furniture as well. It's the only fuel they have, and it helps keep them alive.
It's impossible to exaggerate the sense of isolation felt by the people of Sarajevo. There are more than 300,000 of them living in wretched conditions. Most of the time they don't have running water or electricity. They're entirely dependent on what the outside world cares to provide. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, Sarajevo.
India's cricketers, what is it, where England? India's cricketers dominated the third day of the final test in Bombay. England managed to take just 2 wickets as India moved on to 397 for 3, 50 runs ahead.
Another miserable day for England's captain began well enough when Philip Tufnell had Sidhu smartly caught by Robin Smith. But before another run was added came what proved to be a crucial error, as Cambly on 39 miscued, only for De Freitas in the deep to misjudge his attempted catch. Cambly made England...
Santas.
Ye gods! Are they doing everything in triplicate now?
Now, Ivy, have you any glue?
We've got soup.
No, you're not doing any good down here.
A seasonal edition of Last of the Summer Wine, tonight at 8 o'clock on BBC One.
Before that, we'll be meeting some continental experts in improbable disguises, Rennie and Company in Allo Allo. That's at 7.30. Now on One, Santa faces some difficulties thanks to Patch, his overly enterprising elf. We're off to the North Pole for Santa Claus the Movie.
And from all of us here, good night.
Teams next week in Southampton will be from Midlands and West and Home Counties North in Come Dancing at 10:40 next Monday.
Cancer kills 1 million people in Europe every year, but in most cases it can be prevented. As BBC Television marks Europe Against Cancer Week, there's a special horizon.
This programme is about the vast majority of cancers. It's about how much is known of the steps that individuals themselves might take in order to reduce their own risk.
The Body Matters team return to explain the disease in their own style.
But the fact is that when the number of people who smoke increases, then so do the number of deaths from lung cancer. So by smoking, you are literally gambling with your life.
Daytime's All Well and Good includes an interview with Bob Champion, winner of both the 1981 Grand National and his fight against cancer.
And it's Alban Eady and Bob Champion in the lead.
And through the week, help is there.
The fact that nurses obviously know what they're talking about medically, it was reassuring, and they offered me the emotional support that I needed.
This week, BBC Television marks Europe Against Cancer.
This is BBC One. Now, we have the first of 2 films made in 1985 to celebrate the 150th anniversary of the Great Western Railway.
It would be in people's minds to consider if it was that they were sent out to shoot the people and forget about it afterwards, then we must be aware of this and put controls on the government so that that sort of thing doesn't happen again. Because if they could have been taken alive, they should have been taken alive.
What about the possibility, Roger King, of those 3 IRA men also having a trial?
The ones that were killed?
Yes.
Well, I think that we have a sort of trial in terms of the coroner's inquest, which will take place. I think what happened in that programme was nothing more or
maybe
less...
Maybe a bit too late for them.
Well, it was a journalistic atrocity in that it only presented half the story, was not able, for instance, to interview any of the personnel involved, so how could it come out with a definitive viewpoint, which it obviously did, and led people on? The only people that are laughing over this are the IRA, yeah. who find that the whole inquest now is not on whether the IRA were out to commit this appalling atrocity if they'd got away with it, which they obviously were because it's been confirmed that they were an active service group. But the finger is now being pointed out at the forces of law and order which this company, which this country runs, to protect its citizens. I find that unacceptable, and the media should keep out of these things and let the law take its course. But of course, in providing entertainment, of course, that must come first and foremost for far too many journalists.
Can I go over here?
The basis, in my view, of any civilized society is law and the rule of law and the implementation of that law. And why do we oppose terrorists? Because they are people who have no respect for that.
Fine, yes, let me take that.
There's no such thing as an unjust law.
The way to change that is by democratic means, through the ballot box, and certainly...
You can't fight apartheid by voting against it, can you? Because they can't vote.
Sorry.
You say that again.
They can't fight apartheid, the blacks, by voting about it, because they can't vote.
We're talking about apartheid. We're talking at the moment.
You said about... you're talking about...
We're talking about...
change things.
About Ireland here. We're talking about the Irish situation. We're talking about the film On the Rock, and the three people who, in my view, were murdered. And I have no sympathy for them or their objectives. But when the executive takes on itself to set up assassination squads, we're moving well down the road to being a banana republic.
But surely... I can't reply to that by saying that I feel that obviously you're Irish yourself. And I mean, I'm sort of born in London of Irish parents. And I've been to Belfast quite a few times. And you understand the context more and more, and you get more interested in what's been happening over there for these hundreds of years. And you learn about these things. And the media, in my opinion, which is where most people get their information from, do more about problems, if you call them problems, further away than they do about Ireland. To the extent of the ignorance about Irish politics in England is frightening, I think. Really frightening. It's the ignorance that breeds the sort of attitudes that these people are showing, I think.
Can I go back to the
broad... How can one ever justify?
I'm not justifying.
Just a moment. Would you shut up and listen for a moment, rather than... How can you ever justify the destruction of another human life?
I'm not.
In no matter what terms. Yes, you try to make it
How
right.
How do I do that? I should
like this gentleman here
it
tries
happens,
to make it.
It happens.
Would you shut up
it.
For a moment, please?
I wanted to shift the conversation a little bit. We really have been talking about the effects of terrorism rather than the causes. And I find it extremely difficult to talk purely about the sort of superficial and the hyped up effects of terrorism and not the, and here I go using the term terrorism, which I don't necessarily agree with, rather than talking about the causes. For example, how many of us can actually cast our minds back and think about what the real issues were with regard to the Kuwaiti hijacking or whatever? Very few.
Can I come here?
I think we've got to avoid in the media outside restraints being placed upon us. I'd hate a sort of cult of the Star Chamber being set up from outside and imposed on the media. And I think it the ball's in the court of the media now to regulate itself. And I think the best hope for a solution does lie in Mr. Yardley's much maligned film. I don't think it was naive at all. The media has become obsessed with what is newsworthy, and we're seeing the symptoms constantly being paraded before us, and the illness is forgotten. I mean, what is going on in Beirut? I know Christians are killing Arabs. What is going on there? And one is left with this feeling of mental indigestion all the time. Now, I think it's very much in the power of the media people, perhaps not the ones who've had the job for the last cosy 10 years or so, but perhaps a new young and up-and-coming second, you know, young colonels, perhaps, to change the whole emphasis of how news is presented.
Colin Morris, what is the role of the broadcaster?
Well, there's been an assumption underlying all this discussion that worries me greatly, and that is the assumption that, unwittingly possibly, the media are the allies of terrorism. I mean, someone said over there that, you know, only the IRA would be laughing. I do think that you've got to counterbalance this phrase about the oxygen of publicity with another one about the carbon monoxide of publicity. The notion that terrorists think the media are their great allies is not true. If you look at Enniskillen, the publicity that was given to Enniskillen set back the cause of terrorism by a mile. A lot of the things that are seen are things that they don't want to be seen. And I really think it's simplistic to assume that we're just unwitting allies of terrorism.
And Michael Yardley, a last word from you.
Well, I think it's the job of our media to promote interest, to inform us. And I think it's clear from tonight's discussion that a lot of people have got opinions, and those opinions haven't really got across very often. I think we've got to create mechanisms where broadcasters can speak to the consumers of their product. I don't know specifically how we're going to do that, but I'm quite sure we need to do more of this sort of thing where we come together and actually talk about these problems.
Well, thank you very much for making your film. Thank you to the broadcasters for taking part in this discussion and to the audience for contributing to a very lively debate. Well, that's all from tonight's network. We'll be back in a month, so if there's an issue that you want to raise about television, do let us know, especially if you're interested in making your own film. The address will be coming on in a moment. We'll see you next month. Good night.
And the network address is BBC Television, London, W12, 8QT. That edition of Network was made before tonight's news that Russell Harty had been moved into intensive care. The Broadcasting Complaints Commission has rejected complaints from the National Front about a report on racism and racial abuse on the terraces at football matches contained in Network, broadcast on BBC One on the 16th of June 1987. The Commission does not accept that the report suggested that the National Front condoned football violence. It accepts that the report did link the National Front with the defunct magazine Bulldog, said that the National Front hijacked the British national flag, and described the National Front as a racist group. But it does not consider this unjust or unfair. This is BBC One. Now, the second of two programmes made in 1985 to mark 150 years of the Great Western Railway.
At 8.15 tonight on Channel 4, there's another chance to see the fourth episode of The Jewel in the Crown. That's on 4 in half an hour.
If you want a filling cereal, the answer's written clear. It says Weetabix.
Yeah!
This is a filling station.
It'll fill you up to here!
We're the Weetabix.
A titchy tiny breakfast won't help you start the day.
You make it neat, Wheats, mate. If you know what's good for you, you do.
Okay.
The Weetabix. If you know what's good for you.
Uh-oh. Bad time to call.
Why won't my floor shine like yours, Jill?
Try this.
Ajax Liquid.
I'll show you.
Mmm, smells nice.
Yes, and there's no need to dissolve Ajax Liquid. We'll soon get this floor looking like new. Ajax Liquid cleans so clean, it really lets the shine shine through.
Brilliant. Mmm, it smells clean and fresh, too.
And you use Ajax Liquid to clean chrome and lots of other things like tiles.
Brilliant.
Ajax Liquid, original white or lemon, lets the shine shine through.
Brilliant!
Hello, Richard.
Hello.
You're not still on about this bike, are you? I remember when bikes were bikes.
proper mudguards and a cover for the chain. Look at that saddle. They're like sitting on a razor blade. Maybe next year, eh?
Yeah.
How'd you get on, love?
I think I found one.
Great.
Roper's. Says they'll keep it till weekend.
You better give us the address then.
Good old Yellow Pages. We're not just there for the nasty things in life, like a leaky roof. We can help with the nice things, too.
Is the number up for other hatchbacks? You might decide it is. Because now there is 205, the new number to be reckoned with from Peugeot. 205, with 65.7 MPG petrol economy that beats every other five-door hatchback, plus outstanding performance. 205 lifts you out of that small car feeling, thanks to a new suspension system that gives you big car space and a beautiful big car ride. Add five-door versatility and a starting price of just $3,895. And it not only challenges other hatchbacks, you could say a day of reckoning has arrived. The five-door Peugeot 205, the new number to be reckoned with at your Peugeot Talbot dealer, now.
Push off.
Oh, you don't know what I want yet.
Yes, I do. Every time you come in here, you nick my Holston pills.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you about.
Talk. About Holston pills.
Well, I'm just wondering if you'd sort of, oh, share what you know with me.
Well, most of the sugar turns to alcohol, you see. And then not again.
Harry, get this guy out, will you?
Wait, Jay. Oh, let me. Wait a minute, Jay, will you?
You dirty rat.
Holston pills, the original pills.
Mrs. Bell's nice old cottage has two problems. The first is pretty windows that are drafty. Everest asked if they could help. In just one working day, Everest craftsmen fitted secondary windows inside all the original windows. No mess, no fuss, and no drafts. The second problem is some very noisy neighbours. Fetch him over, Jim! Now listen carefully. That's Everest soundproofing for you. You only fit double glazing once, so fit the best. Ooh, Everest.
I spy something beginning with W.
Water. I spy something beginning with S.
Sky.
No, sea. I...
Ahoy! Are you the lot who ordered the Philips colour television?
Yes!
Just look at those golden wheat fields. And the beautiful emerald hues of those towering oaks.
Ah, that's because of a clever little thing Philips call primary colour balance.
It's just how I'll remember it.
Well, it's about time they got something like this in. I don't know about you, but I was very near breaking point.
Philips televisions with primary colour balance. Colours so natural, you could almost be there.
Everything all right, Norman?
Yeah, quite.
Half an hour tonight, Tom.
Take hold, everybody. Plain Bob Minimus.
What's up?
Something wrong, Robert.
Nothing should disturb that condor moment.
Harp Heating. Prices held. Save £100 plus no deposit finance with nothing to pay till July. Ring 464-6575 now.
From the beer halls of fame shine out two gallant names, twin champions of Whitbread best beer. And one had this theory on drinking our beer. He was Abdul the Bulbul Amir. As a rule, said Abdul, gravitational pull makes you sup standing up at the bar. Then a voice did declare, Whitbread's best in a chair. It was Ivan Skavinsky Skavar. Well, those gampy old goofs got it out nail and tooth, but neither of them was correct.
Sitting down, standing up with Fred's not all that fast,
'cause the best needs no etiquette.
Come on, folks. From now on, Dreamy Cadbury's Caramel is down 3p in price to only 17p. So now you can all afford to take it easy. Cadbury's Caramel, now only 17p.
Since 1924, when we introduced them, Kellogg's Corn Flakes have remained the original and the best. Now, we've made them a little crisper than ever before. And to celebrate, what better than a bright new pack?